Hey, it's Mark Podolsky, the Land Geek, with your favorite niche real estate website, www.thelandgeek.com. And before we talk to today's guest, I'd be remiss if I didn't properly introduce my co-host. You know him. You love him. Scott Todd from scotttodd.net, landmodo.com. Most importantly, if you're not automating your Craigslist and your Facebook postings, postingdomination.com/thelandgeek. Scott Todd, how are you?
Mark, I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing well. Are you ready for today's guest?
I can't wait.
Yeah? All right. Well, I just wanted to let all of the listeners know today's podcast is sponsored by geekpay.io, the only set it and forget it financial CRM. And, you know, it's assuring you're going to get paid. Scott, is there something playing in your background there? I hear something on. Is it on my end?
Feedback.
No, something's playing. Chris, do you hear that?
I hear a teeny bit.
What do you hear?
Maybe it's an echo. I don't know. But there it's go. Now it's gone. All right. Well, we kind of let the cat out of the bag because today's guest is Chris Miles from MoneyRipples.com. Chris is your financial advisor and money mentor. He is the cash flow expert, a leading authority on how to quickly create cash flow and lasting wealth for thousands of his clients, entrepreneurs, and others internationally. He's been featured in U.S. News, CNN Money, Bankrate.com, and has a high reputation for getting his clients life-altering financial results in his company, Money Ripples. So, Chris Miles, how are you?
Fabulous. How are you doing?
I'm great. So let's just rewind the tape and learn more about how you came up with the idea of Money Ripples.
You know what? I started out as a traditional financial advisor. You know, I was the guy that told you to save everything, spend nothing, put all in crappy mutual funds and 401ks and IRAs and all that kind of crap that doesn't work, right?
Right.
People do that forever and you know, somehow they become financially free. And I found out that pretty quickly as I started to associate people that were millionaires and people that were business owners, that they would laugh and scoff at it. They're like, this is crap, you know? And so I was a financial advisor during the whole Y2K era. So, you know, great time to be a financial advisor, right? And did that for 4 years.
Yeah, great.
And so beginning of 2006, I said, you know, I can't take it anymore. I'm done. I quit. I will go teach ballroom dancing and do mortgages. And so that's what I did. And I started to do that. And then in 2006, I actually got to a point where I got some of those guys, same guys to mentor me and get me to shift my perspective. And I was actually able to retire when I was 28 years old in July of 2006. And
wait a second. How did you make enough money to retire in 2006?
Well, that's where I learned that cash
flow. 28.
Yeah. That's, you know, people talk about cash is king. You know, there's a famous guy in, you know, good old Tennessee that says that. Right. And that's kind of crap because cash doesn't mean anything if it doesn't actually create cash flow. And so when I realized that cash flow, like if I create other streams of income, and so I got really good at creating passive or residual streams of income that I was able to retire and I only had like a couple thousand dollars in my checking account. I realized I didn't have to have a lot as long as I had those streams of income coming in. And back then I only had two kids, you know, I have now with my married wife, eight total. Back then two kids, you know, I could live on $4,000 a month pretty easily. You know, this nowadays it's like, you got to have at least five figures a month to survive, you know?
So, you know, you're totally preaching to the choir here, Chris, because this is what Scott and I do, basically.
Yeah.
With our land investing is we just create cash flow, but we've got this passive income coming every single month. We have to deal with renters, rehabs, renovations, or rodents. So how did you create your stream of income?
So mine came a few different ways. I started to do a little bit of real estate as well, you know, and that helped. I was pretty crappy at it in the beginning, especially because, you know, I didn't care about cash flow as long as I got the equity out of it. I was just stripping equity and stuff, right? But beyond that, I actually did really well with kind of what people refer to today as affiliate marketing, like joint ventures and things like that. Even though I quit being a financial advisor and I vowed never to go back to it again, right? I was like, I'm never going to teach about money. I'll just teach ballroom dancing. I'm done. I'll do mortgages. At least I can't, you know, feel like I'm, because the reason I quit is because I felt like I was lying to people. You know, like I felt I was out of integrity to tell people, hey, you're going to save, you know, so many hundreds of dollars a month, and you'll retire a millionaire, which I knew when I looked at the real numbers, it was never going to happen. So I was like, I can't teach this stuff again. Like I can't, I feel like I was a liar and a deceiver for 4 years. But what ended up happening is people still came to me. They still said, Chris, yeah, but you know, who should I talk to do, you know, this or that? And I remember one of my friends who was a millionaire, he said, Chris, do you like doing mortgages? I said, you know, not really. Like I love teaching people and helping them with it, but I hate when people call me at all hours of the night wondering if the loan's going to close. And it was just the next day after I did an application. It's like, I told you 3 weeks and you're calling me the next day wondering if it's going to close today. No. And so he said, well, why don't you find somebody else who will do that for you? And it blew my mind, because in a scarcity world where you think that, you know, there's only so much resources, so much commissions, all that kind of stuff, I would never think about splitting cases. But then I thought, you know, that's a good idea. And so I found a guy who was really good on the back end that loved to do paperwork, but wasn't a great social kind of guy. I said, hey, if I just give you people to pretty much do paperwork and then they're going to do their mortgage, you don't have to do any selling. You know, would you be willing to split that? He said, well, of course, who wouldn't? And so we did. So I started splitting that. And next thing I know, I'm seeing, like, after a half hour or so of work, I'm like, wow, I'm getting like $1,000 or $2,000 a month from that. Hey, what else could I do from a half hour worth of work, you know, or an hour worth of work? So I started partnering up with other people. Even wholesale jewelers that would pay a 5% referral fee. I'm like, cool. I use you guys all the time. I refer you to you anyways. And so all these people I was already referring to, I was like, well, why not just connect them and get a piece out of that? And so what became almost accidental for me at that time was, all of a sudden through referring, I was making $4,000 or $5,000 a month just referring, you know, not including the real estate stuff I was doing, you know?
I love it. Scott Todd, what are your thoughts?
Well, I mean, like Mark said, you're kind of preaching to the choir here, right? Like we're all about passive income. And, yeah. You know, one of the things that I think that a lot of people try to do though, is they try to kind of spread themselves too thin, right? Like I was talking to the guy the other day and he's like, oh man, I've got 7 businesses. And I'm like, well, okay, how are all these 7 businesses related? He's like, they're not. And I'm like, then you don't, like you have 7 messes. Because there's no way that you can be good and proficient at all 7 of them. You know, maybe if you get that's it right up and running and build a team to run it for you, great. Then you have 7 businesses, right? But as it is, you have 7 hobbies is what, what it amounts to. And, you know, I mean, Chris, I really relate to some of the stuff that you're saying too, because Mark, when I was sitting in my daytime job and I jumped on your webinar that talks about the land investing, I mean, like, you know, I was already like a believer. I had listened to the podcast. I was seeing it. I'm like, man, this is ridiculous. Why did I not think about this sooner? And what's crazy is that I was watching your webinar, driving to a doctor's appointment for my son. Like I was meeting my family there. And you said something in the webinar that really like shocked me, because when I thought of freedom and I thought of retirement, I wrote down this big, massive number, right? Like it was millions. And I'm like, okay, I got to save my way to millions of dollars. And Mark, you said in the webinar, you said, hey, this produces the same amount of cash flow as like $2.8 million of having $2.8 million in the bank or whatever the number was. I forgot what it was. And right then I'm like, holy cow, that was like close to my number, right? And all of a sudden I'm like, what am I doing? And you know, I think that that's what a lot of people miss too, is that people want to have this number in the bank account. Chris, you said you have like, you know, that like thousands of dollars in the bank account. That's about it. You don't need a ton of money in the bank account, right? What you need is you need mailbox money. You need the money coming in every single month, and you need to build kind of connected streams. And like for me and Mark, you know, we build land connected streams. So, you know, like it's a land payment. It's a land payment. It's all of these land payments. I mean, I have like hundreds of notes every month, and you know, they pay the bill, right? They pay all the bills, all because they're kind of focused in what we do, land.
I love that.
Yeah. I mean, and Chris, how did you kind of shift mentally from this mindset of scarcity mentality to abundance mentality, in the sense that, I mean, basically what you said was, look, I can always make more money, but I can't get more time. So how do I create more time? And, you know, here's 30 minutes leverage to make, you know, $1,000 or $2,000 extra a month.
Yeah. You know, it kind of ties in a lot with what Scott was saying as well. Like it's, you know, there's a few myths I had to get overcome. One is that there's 3 different mentalities when it comes to money. There's a spender mentality, which everybody rips on, right? Like everybody says like, oh, the spender is the one that lose all the money. they're actually really close to getting it right. But they're also in scarcity because they always have to keep working and hustling to keep that lifestyle going, right? But there's also the savers. And the savers are also in scarcity because savers are taught that you can never save enough. You can never pay off debt fast enough. Like, it's just never enough. It doesn't matter what the number is. The number will always have to be bigger, right? It'll never be enough. Even if you could get them to get their cash flow to that place, they still won't feel like it's enough. Like, you can't ever be financially free if you're in a place of scarcity. And so that's where the third paradigm comes in, which is being a steward. See, a steward takes the best of the spender and the saver and puts in one person. Because the savers, at least, are willing to be wise and willing to think about it. Sometimes they just think too long or don't think at all. They just save. They just go on autopilot, right? But spenders are at least willing to use money. They just use it and it doesn't come back, right? So if you could use money in a way that it comes back, especially when it creates cash flow, and you're using money to create value for people, especially if you're going into business, your whole focus, that was the biggest thing for me that changed in 2006, is that I stopped asking, how do I make more money? But I started asking, how do I start creating more value for more people? What's the win-win? How can I get people what they want? Kind of like the whole thing you hear from like Jim Rohn, right? You know, like get enough people what they want and you'll get what you want and that kind of thing. It's like, what are the people wanting? And people kept asking me for advice, whether I wanted to give it or not. They still wanted to know, you know, how I could help them financially. The great thing is I was able to start connecting with the right people. And as I started to shift too, my mentality, everything got better. I started to shift theirs and then they could go and apply strategies better. So I think that's one of the big keys right there is one, having that steward mentality where you're focusing on creating value and making things better, right? And it's on acceleration of money, not accumulation of money. The second thing that Scott had mentioned about multiple streams of income, you know, I found that an interesting way back in 2008 because I thought, hey, you know, I have all these passions. Why not create cash flow streams from all of my passions? And so I had like, not only did I have my financial business that I was coaching people on, because I came out of retirement in 2008 or 2007 to do that. And then I also had like an insurance business and I had a dinner and dance business. I was teaching ballroom dancing and doing a catered dinner and stuff, right? And I had a network marketing business I was doing and I can't remember the fifth one. I had five streams of income. All of them were paying, but funny enough, I was making less money per month than I was when I cut off three of those and focused on only two. So even though I had multiple streams of income, that's the whole, you know, sexy thing about it. It's like, hey, you got to have multiple streams of income. That's true, but you got to build it right, you know? So that was a big aha for me as well. It's like, oh, you know, you got to build it, but build it, you know, be more focused in how you're building it. And then as you get that system established, then maybe you venture out beyond that. But stay in your lane, stay what you do best.
Yeah, that's so true. And, you know, the Pareto principle and that as well. I mean, it kind of reminds me of what Steve Jobs did when he came back to Apple. They had, you know, 14 different lines. He's like, and he's got it down to like three, uh-huh. Right? And they, you know, made a lot more money. You know, we kind of talked about in the beginning, but is there some kind of worst advice that you see or hear given in money management?
Yeah, that's the other one that Scott mentioned. So save up money, accumulate, and then try to live on the interest, right? And understand that financial advisors nowadays are telling you to live on 2 to 3% of your money. So if you want a $60,000 a year lifestyle today, we're not even talking about inflation, just today, you need to save up at least $2 or $3 million, right? That's pretty dang hard to do. And by the way, if you start factoring in inflation, more likely than not, you're going to have to save, depending on what age you're at or what goal you're going for, you might have to save at least $8 or $10 million to just make financial planning work. And I'll tell you, it's a crock of crap. Like, it doesn't work. I've ran the numbers. There's no way by doing the traditional mutual fund type of investments, you are ever, ever, unless you inherit money, you're ever going to retire. I'm just telling you flat out to be honest, like it just doesn't work. Your only hope is to do things that are more alternative type of investments. You know, things where you are doing things with real estate and things like that. You know, or like I have some clients that they're trying to get some tax breaks with oil and gas or whatever it might be. And then if they earn cash flow, sweet, it's a perk, it's a bonus. But it really, the focus, you got to get away from the whole mentality of saving and saving. Cause I thought I'd have to save till I was 40. I'm 40 now. I thought I'd have to save $2 million to be able to retire at a middle-class lifestyle. And the truth is you don't. It's so much easier. At the same time, so much harder because you do have to shift that perspective. You got to look at money with a totally new set of eyes to even see the opportunity right there in front of you.
Yeah. I mean, Scott,
yeah.
What are your thoughts? Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, like, I agree. Like the model that people want to follow, like, you know, you have to get, for you to build that type of income, you either need to like really make it well within like an executive type of a job to where, you know, like they're throwing buku dollars at you, or you have to be prepared to kind of like not eat in retirement. Right. And like, I look way back when, you know, I too worked as a financial advisor, and this guy that I really love, he was a crazy Navy SEAL. He would tell his clients, he would say, you know, because they were terrified of the stock market, and he would say, do you want to sleep today or eat tomorrow? Right. And you know, that stuck with me for a long time. Like, okay, do I want to sleep today on my investments so you, by its nature, that's kind of like a risky player, right? Like, mm-hmm. Don't worry about today. You know, we're going to go a little bit riskier because you're going to be able to eat later on. But I can tell you, like, I sleep well today and I know I'm going to eat well in the future, right? Like, it's just, once you start to build that passive income stream, it's crazy how fast the money snowballs. It really is.
Yeah. I mean, does it ever bother you, Chris, when you hear, you know, these financial advisors, like we had one on our podcast and she was like, look, I save 80% of my income. And, you know, she is willing to give up a lot of luxury in her life and lifestyle in her life in exchange for this, you know, quote unquote security, and then being able to say like travel, right? And just live on very, very little money. What are your thoughts on that as far as going into sort of deprivation mode, but kind of telling yourself, well, yeah, you know, nobody really needs a really nice, you know, 5-star resort. We can stay at Motel 6 and mm-hmm. still have just as good a time. And nobody needs to go to, you know, a $300 dinner. We can have beans and rice and just get as many calories and fill up. And in the same time, like, look how much I'm saving, right? And in doing that, what are your thoughts on sort of that mindset?
It's funny you mentioned that, because I actually have an ebook on my website that's called Beyond Rice and Beans, 7 Secrets to Free Up Cash Today, which talks about how my clients all have freed up on average $34,000 a year, right? And it's funny because, like, that's the very thing you got to be careful of that. Like, I'm okay if somebody's saving 80% as long, because I want people to be a wise steward, but don't do it at the expense of your happiness today. Because here's the truth is, we have no clue how long we're going to live. If someone sacrifices 80%, lives on rice and beans, sacrifices their health to the point where by the time they finally get to retirement, they can't even walk anymore. Like, what was the purpose of that? Why save all the money? I mean, money is meant to be spent. It's meant to be used. The Egyptians thought it was differently, and all they did was got their tombs robbed, right? They got buried with their wealth because they thought, hey, I'm going to die with my wealth. You can't take it with you. The real question is, what are you going to do with that wealth while you're alive today? And you can either, you know, sacrifice it forever and be that cheapskate that nobody likes to go out to dinner with because you'll make them pay. You know, you'll be the person that tells your kids that, hey, you'd be basically like how I was raised, right? Where I was told, hey, what do you think? Money grows on trees. I'm not made out of money. You know, we can't afford this. Like all that kind of scarcity conditioning that was instilled into me that I had to undo, because I was raised with that depression era mentality. You know, like, it just doesn't work. It does not. Even if you had all the money in the world, if you don't have true financial freedom, who cares? Like, that's the real truth. And so I think, great, power to, if she can save 80% and do it abundantly, in the sense that she's not delaying life forever. She's not, you know, saying, well, someday I will spend time with my kids. Someday I'll do this. Someday I'll do that. If you're constantly saying that, you're in trouble. Like, you, that someday will become never. And that's the big worry that I have for people like that.
Yeah. What about you, Scott, as far as, you know, making that shift from scarcity mentality to abundance mentality?
Well, I'll tell you, like, Mark, I've said it before, like, when I started the land business, I was very, I didn't have an abundant mindset, you know, like I was really scarcity mindset. And I'll tell you, like, at my very first boot camp, I'm sitting there and you pull up, like, you know, you do a deal, right? Like, you're at boot camp, you start off like, let's do a deal. And the county that you chose was the county that I was having success in. Okay. And I literally, I kid you not, I started sweating, right? Like, oh my gosh, the secret is out. Oh my gosh. Now look, this is not a county that I discovered either. This was a county that I found that you were already in, and I'm like stealing off of you, right? Like I'm just copying you. So, but I'm sweating, right? I'm like sweating bullets. Like, oh my gosh, I'm done. I have to find a new county now. And you know what happened is I continued to do deals there, right? Like I continued to do deals and do deals. And then I would see other people were selling properties there. And I'm like, what? Like, it's not affecting me. And all of a sudden you start to realize like, man, there truly is enough for all of us, right? Mm-hmm. Like there truly is enough for all of us. And, you know, sometimes if competition rises, you know what, you need to bring up your game because the market will speak to the better of the competitors. Right. And I think at that point, when I saw that other people were still able to do deals, I was able to do deals there. And, you know, 3 years later, I'm still doing deals in that county. It doesn't really matter, right? Like it doesn't. And all of a sudden you realize like, man, there's enough for all of us. Bring it on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Chris, what are your thoughts on that as far as, you know, enough and how do you define enough?
Enough can become two ways because you could go in scarcity by saying, oh, I have enough. Like I have enough, like, oh, I'm done. You're like, you know, you put a limitation on yourself, which you got to be careful of that. But I actually, in that context though, of there's enough and there's more than enough to spare, right? If people really realize that, it's huge. It reminds me of, if you know Ben Stein, you know,
he's the economist, like, but he's like Bueller. Yes,
exactly. He's the actors like Bueller, anyone, voodoo economics.
That's right. Yeah.
That guy, right? So it's interesting. Yeah, he was an economist. His dad was actually a famous economist as well, was from Harvard and everything. In fact, Ben Stein went to Harvard in economics. And he would do, I remember he did an article for Yahoo Finance for quite a while. And one of the articles, he talked about something his dad taught him. Because in the 1950s in school, they're telling them, hey, in 10 years, we're going to run out of food. People are going to start starving and dying. So he went to his dad and he said, Dad, we're going to run out of food. People are going to start starving and dying. His dad said, no, it won't. But it will. Like the figures say it will. No, it won't. But Dad, figures don't lie. He said, son, figures don't lie, but liars figure. You know, and there's a lot of financial advisors out there that teach that, you know, that they use all their figures and numbers to try to show you something that's way overpromised and underdelivered, right? And it's funny because, like, you know, when you mention competition, like I don't see people, is people say, hey, this person's your competition. No, they're not, because they can't do what I do. Now, technically, if they own their brilliance, I can't do what they do either, and that's perfect. In fact, I married my competition, someone who is viewed as my competitor. In fact, she used to be a Dave Ramsey teacher, funny enough. You know, so we had some interesting discussions, obviously, over the years. But yeah, like, and actually, we've come to pretty good agreement because she realized that he teaches in scarcity too. And it's funny, like people would say, "Oh, you're competitors." I'm like, no, we're not. Like, I don't do what she does, and she doesn't do what I do. Like, I rock. I'm amazing. And if you think about it, because all the financial advisors out there, that created a need for an anti-financial advisor like myself to even exist in the first place. Because there's all these people teaching the same old crap. It's like, hey, let's stop teaching about saving for 30 or 40 years. What if we could retire in 5 to 10 years? Let's do that now, or get us to quit our jobs within 5 or 10 years so we can do what we love regardless of the money. Like that's kind of like where my focus is. It's the exact opposite of what financial advisors teach you to do, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you're so preaching to the choir here, Chris, but we're at that point now in the podcast where we got to put you on the spot, and your mentorship has been invaluable, but we're going to ask you for one more tip of the week, a website, a resource, a book, something actionable where the Art of Passive Income listeners can go right now, improve their businesses, improve their lives. What have you got?
You know, I would say if you're looking for books, of course, like, you know, if you haven't read Rich Dad Poor Dad, read that. You know, understand the concepts in that one. I mean, it's kind of basic for us right now, but it really does lay the foundation, because I read it as a financial advisor and try to make it fit in that perspective, but you got to shift out of that. You got to avoid that completely. I'll tell you the one main point that I got out of it was cash flow. And if you want more cash flow, if you want to get to the heart of where cash flow comes from, go to what I said earlier, which is dollars follow value. You know, the only reason money comes to you, there's no, I mean, it's not that land doesn't pay you money. It's the people behind the land that pays you money. There's got to be some value exchange, something created that money wants to be exchanged. Otherwise, you're just gambling. It's just like in stock markets, like you're just riding waves, but there's no real value creation. And therefore, there's no real predictability. You're just a gambler. You're not an investor if you're trading in the markets. And I know I traded, I taught people, 200 people how to trade stocks and options in the market. And I told every one of them, you're a gambler, not an investor if you're doing this. Because you're not a true investor if you're in the stock market like that. The real way to really become a good investor with sure returns is to figure out, how am I creating value? What am I doing to create value for people where they want to pay me money? And that's the easiest thing to do. Stop asking how to make more money.
I love it. I love it. Scott Todd, what's your tip of the week?
Mark, look, there are some people that I know that have a hard time waking up in the morning. Okay, like they just have a hard time. So I've got an app for them. I'm not one of them, by the way, but if you are, here you go. It's called Rocket Alarm. I know it's an iPhone app. I don't know if it's on Android or not, but Rocket Alarm.
Rocket Alarm.
What it does is, it sets an alarm, it wakes you up, and then what it does is it actually presents to you a new challenge, like a new game, if you will. Sometimes you have to blow into the microphone to like keep the balloon up or something else. And so basically what it does is it gets you interacting with your alarm clock so that you just can't hit the snooze button and go back to bed. You actually have to begin to interact with your phone, you know, play a game, solve a mystery, solve a puzzle to force you to at least start to move your feet, right?
So I like this. Interact.
So if you have trouble waking up, check this out.
Very cool.
I'm gonna check that out too.
Now I you know what I do is I put my phone on my like away from my bed, so I'm forced to get up and then snooze it, and then basically it's like decision time. Like, do I go back to bed? And what's funny is I actually read this Mel Robbins book, The 5 Second Rule, and she actually made the argument like it's really bad for you to go back to bed. And like after that, I'm like, no, I'm never, you know, hitting snooze.
See, I like wake up, like my alarm goes off. I wake up. I immediately like sit up so that, and I try to put my feet on the ground. Right. Because then you just go, right. Like you just start moving when you start to do that. And, it works. Right. And if you need to just jump in the shower and off you go.
Yeah. Chris, you take cold showers?
Not today.
Yeah, I'm doing the cold shower thing. I love it. It's you want to talk about waking up alert. It's great. So
yeah, I work out. That's how I wake up.
You work out?
Yeah.
What do you do?
Every other day I either do strength training, like go work out at the gym, or I go running. I actually do half marathons and races like that.
Oh, you're one of those guys, one of those endurance guys.
I don't do the full marathons anymore. I'm 40, you know. I'm done with the full.
Yeah. No, you're one of those super uber fit people. Like, you know, go to the restaurant, order kale salad, you know.
Not anymore.
No? Yeah.
No, actually, I mean, it's funny enough. I actually started going organic non-GMO. I lost 30 pounds of last year. And
wow.
Run faster.
Holy cow. Organic non-GMO.
Yeah.
Amazing.
It makes a big difference.
Scott, you ever heard of that?
No.
I think this is a new ebook for Chris. How I lost 30 pounds going organic non-GMO. I'll buy it.
Yeah. I mean, it's another passive income stream for you, Chris.
There it is. Well, my tip of the week is learn more about Chris Miles at moneyripples.com. Moneyripples.com. Lots of resources, advice. He's got a podcast, right, Chris?
Yeah. I'm going to have you on, in fact.
Yeah. So I'm going to be on, which will be amazing.
Yeah, and Chris Miles Money Show. It's a great show.
Yeah, so check that out on iTunes and all the interwebs areas where you can find Chris. So we'll have links to all of it as well. Also, I just want to remind everybody, just do us, if you're enjoying the podcast, and I know you are because you're listening to them, do us a little favor. It's a little simple thing. Just subscribe, rate, review the podcast, send us a screenshot of your review to support@thelandgeek.com. We're going to send you for free the $97 passive income launch kit. It's the only way we're going to get the quality guests like a Chris Miles from moneyripples.com to come on the podcast. So please do that. Subscribe, rate, and review. send us a screenshot, support@thelandgeek.com, and we'll send you for free the $97 Passive Income Lunch Kit. Again, today's podcast is sponsored by the only automated financial CRM. Get paid, geekpay.io. Get your first note for free at thelandgeek.com/geekpay. Scott, are we good?
We're good, Mark.
Chris, are we good?
We're great, yeah.
All right. Let's I'll let Scott let him lead us out.
Freedom
ring.
Ring.
Let freedom ring. Chris, you like that?
I love it. I love freedom.
We used to try to sync that together and it just got real awkward.
It was terrible. Chris,
it was terrible.
It was like Jerry Maguire like yelling, "Show me the money."
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Worse.
Exactly. All right. Thanks, guys.
Thanks.